My name's John Logsdon. I'm a professor emeritus, which means a retired professor locally at George Washington University. I've been there since 1970, so I know the way around this city. Here's what's going to happen tonight. I know it's not been terribly clear from the program. We've been doing this somewhat on a real-time basis. I'm going to make a few remarks on why we went to the moon and how politically we made it happen. That'll take about 15 minutes or so. Then Dr. Aldrin has some prepared remarks he's going to share with us for 15 or 20 minutes or so. Then I will be joined by Rick Armstrong and Doug Wheelock in these chairs for a kind of informal panel Q&A. We're on a pretty tight timeline, so it's unlikely there'll be time for questions from the audience. We'll entertain ourselves and hopefully you. One rule, no autographs. I've been asked several times already whether Buzz and Doug, Rick, are willing to sign autographs, and in a crowd this big, it just doesn't work. So please don't try and expect that to happen. All right, now I take a deep breath and put on my professor hat and talk about the fact that once we indeed went to the moon, as we talk for the Artemis program about launching an SLS once every 2 years, it's kind of remarkable to think back what happened. In 11 months between December 68 and November 1969, we launched 5 Saturn V in a year. 4 of those 5 took crew to the moon, 2 to orbit, and 2 to the surface. Total of 9 Apollo missions to the moon in a little under 4 years. 4 years. And Apollo 17 left the moon December the 14th, 1972, 47 years ago, and we haven't been back since. You know, one of the things we won't have too much time to talk about tonight is, so what? Was, as Arthur Schlesinger suggested, Apollo one of the greatest events of the 20th century, if not the greatest? Certainly for me it was. My legitimacy for giving these remarks is the book I wrote in 2010 called John F. Kennedy and the Race to the Moon, and a career of work that led to that. So, first of all, Apollo dates back to almost the origins of NASA. First human spaceflight program was Mercury in October of 1958. By the end of 1959, NASA had chosen sending people to the moon as the long-term goal of its human spaceflight program. At that point, after 1970, it was the goal. Announced the program to do that in mid-1960 and called it Apollo. At that point, mainly a circumlunar and Earth orbit program, but some planning for eventual missions to the moon, so that Apollo wasn't made up overnight. President Eisenhower had no interest in doing something like that, but he was the lamest of lame ducks. This was the end of 1960. He had only a few weeks left in office. John Kennedy had been elected president in November of 1960, had not really thought much about space. He assigned the space portfolio to his vice president, Lyndon Johnson, to chair the National Space Council, which is how Mike Pence has the job today. When he was first asked what he wanted to do with future human spaceflight, he said, basically, I really haven't thought about it enough. Come back to me the next budget cycle in a few months and we'll talk about it. Then, Yuri Gagarin, April the 12th, 1961. Like Sputnik, the first human orbital flight was a propaganda victory for the Soviet Union, and in the zero-sum character of the Cold War period, a victory for the Soviet Union was a loss for the United States. And that's the way that Kennedy saw it. Kennedy was an extremely competitive person, thought about the global and domestic political impact of the Soviet successes, and came to the conclusion that it was unacceptable to let the Soviet Union dominate in this new era of human activity. He brought his advisors together, told them at the end of a meeting, there's nothing more important than figuring out how to regain or become the leader in space. He wrote this classic one-page memo, or at least signed it if he didn't write it, with the first paragraph setting out some requirements. You can read it. I'll read a little bit of it. You know, do we have a chance of beating the Soviets? Is there any other space program which promises dramatic results in which we could win? It's a pretty clear set of requirements. Space, dramatic, win. He asked Lyndon Johnson to run a consultation to answer those questions, and the answer came back, the moon, go to the moon. Why? There was a technical reason. Wernher von Braun was brought in as a consultant in this review and told the vice president that if the first objective for both countries would be landing, sending a crew to the surface of the moon and returning them to Earth, because the existing Soviet rocket, the R-7, was not powerful enough for that mission. The Soviet Union would have to build a new rocket. The United States would have to build a new rocket. Dr. von Braun was not a particularly modest person. He said, you, the United States, have me, and the Soviets don't. We will win a rocket-building race. And he was right. In one dimension, Apollo was a rocket-building race, and one which, with the Saturn V, the remarkable Saturn V, we won. The political rationale had nothing to do with space exploration. You see the words, it's men, not merely machines, that captures the imagination of the world, and that large-scale space projects were part of the battle along the fluid front of the Cold War. Kennedy accepted that advice, and on May the 25th, 1961.
Achievements in space which occurred in recent weeks should have made clear to us all, as did the Sputnik in 1957, the impact of this adventure on the minds of men everywhere who are attempting to make a determination of which road they should take. I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth. No single space project in this period will be more impressive to mankind or more important for the long-range exploration of space.
Notice the words there, impress. This was a propaganda undertaking to send a message that the United States was a powerful, rich country capable of doing great things. And that's the message that Apollo was intended to communicate to the rest of the world. Kennedy not only said the words, he made the decisions to turn the words into reality. This is, if you look at these numbers, a peaceful but warlike mobilization of human and financial resources. NASA budget went up 89% the first year, 101% second year, 40% the third year, billions of dollars invested in facilities that we're still using today. NASA's civil service workforce doubled and the contractor workforce quadrupled. So this was a real national effort to get the job done. Kennedy had second thoughts along the way. He was just, you know, a thoughtful person. He kept saying, is it really worth it? Is it really worth it? He kept answering the question, yes. So in September of 1962, he made an inspection trip, went to Huntsville, to the Cape, and then to Houston, and then to St. Louis, where the Gemini capsule was being built, to inspect progress, knowing that he had some tough budget decisions. And there he made his most famous speech, which was not his announcement of the decision to go to the moon, even though the people in Houston would like to think so. They'd like to think they have a winning baseball team, too, but that's another. So you've seen this again, but it's important, I think, to hear Kennedy.
Many years ago, the great British explorer George Mallory, who was to die on Mount Everest, was asked why did he want to climb it. He said, because it is there. Well, space is there, and we're going to climb it. And the moon and the planets are there, and new hopes for knowledge and peace are there. And therefore, as we set sail, we ask God's blessing on the most hazardous and dangerous and greatest adventure on which man has ever embarked. Thank you.
1963, growing questioning of Apollo, growing criticism from both the left and right sides of the political spectrum. Congress had lost its initial enthusiasm, was ready to cut the NASA budget by 10%. The United States had prevailed in the Cuban Missile conflict in October of 1962, and the close call of nuclear war had sobered Kennedy and Khrushchev. And they both thought, how do we avoid that? Kennedy laid out what he called a new strategy for peace in a commencement address in June of 1963. That changed the political context for Apollo, so that Kennedy had a different idea. He had been an advocate of cooperation since his inaugural address. 10 days after the initial announcement, he had met Khrushchev in Vienna and said, why don't we do it together? And Khrushchev said no. And then on September the 20th, 1963, which I find most people don't know or don't remember, he went to the UN.
Finally, in a field where the United States and the Soviet Union have a special capacity in the field of space, there is room for new cooperation, for further joint efforts in the regulation and exploration of space. I include among these possibilities a joint expedition to the moon.
It's interesting to speculate what would have happened if Kennedy had lived and if Khrushchev this time had said yes. But you can't run alternative histories. There was a major review again in 1963 of the program, and as part of that review, Kennedy visited the Cape Canaveral once again, November the 16th, was briefed on the emerging Apollo plans, that's the top picture, then went out to the launch pad where a Saturn I rocket was being prepared for launch in a month or so, and he was told by von Braun that would give the U.S. the lead in lift capability, and he was very impressed and very enthusiastic, said, Apollo needs my support and I intend to give it. Unfortunately, 6 days later, he was felled by an assassin's bullet. Before that, he made a final space speech, which again I find most people don't know, and it happens to be my favorite, so let me play a little of it.
We have a long way to go, many weeks and months and years of long, tedious work lies ahead. There will be setbacks and frustrations and disappointments. There will be, as there always are, pressures on this country to do less in this area as in so many others, and temptations to do something else that's perhaps easier. But this research here must go on. This space effort must go on. The conquest of space must and will go ahead. That much we know. That much we can say with confidence and conviction. Frank O'Connor, the Irish writer, tells in one of his books, How as a Boy, he and his friends would make their way across the countryside. And when they came to an orchard wall that seemed too high and too doubtful to try,
and too difficult to permit their voyage to continue, they took off their hats and tossed them over the wall, and then they had no choice but to follow them. This nation has tossed its cap over the wall of space, and we have no choice but to follow it.
I like listening to Kennedy talk. So, unfortunately, Kennedy's assassination put the final block in the certainty that Apollo would happen, because it became a memorial to a fallen young president, and nobody was going to cancel it. So, July the 16th, 1969, Apollo 11 roared off the launch pad. The young, much thinner person in that red circle is me, and nobody here can prove it's not. But I know where I was. And 4 days later...
Listen, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
That's Buzz coming down the ladder. So here we are in 2019, 50 years late after Apollo 11. Are we on the edge of something equivalent to a Kennedy moment? There's been a lot of discussion here this week, and Dr. Aldrin has some words to say on that. Will we hear something like this again?
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one that we're willing to accept, one we are unwilling to postpone, and one we intend to win, and the others too.
That's where we are. Let's see where we can go. Thank you. So now it's very much my pleasure and privilege to bring to the stage a global citizen and a true American icon, Buzz Aldrin. Buzz?
Good evening. What a wonderful time to be alive in this universe, on this earth. A vision from here forward. Theodore Roosevelt was the first president to ride in a plane, submarine, car, and use a telephone. He dared and did where others wondered and worried. He also built the Panama Canal, which many said could not be done. The point is, he looked forward and was a man of action, shaping the future. That is how we must be thinking today. Almost 110 years ago, Teddy Roosevelt gave his famous Man in the Arena speech, where he said, "It is not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles, or where the doer of deeds could have done better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs and comes short again and again, because there is no effort without error and shortcoming. But who does actually strive to do the deeds? Who knows the great enthusiasms, the great devotions? Who spends himself in a worthy cause? Who at best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement? And who at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who know neither victory nor defeat. Historically, America has always dared greatly and been rewarded for our daring. We pioneered human space exploration, human space flight. These acts of daring did not come without sacrifice, including loss of astronauts, time, and resources, but they did deliver the future. America was not only the first, and today remains the only nation to land men on the moon. Those investments in daring returned everything from satellite communications to artificial limbs, from fire equipment, solar cells, an insulin pump, Velcro to scratch resistant contact lenses, from plastics to iPhones, and shock-absorbent running shoes. The polymers in our spacesuits now save lives in fire-resistant suits for firefighters, while space-based water filtration technology now saves lives in remote places around the Earth. And think of the other rewards from daring to go into space. Wireless headsets, smoke detectors, freeze-dried foods, yuck. Tiny, hardy cameras, air purifiers, memory foam, ear thermometers, airplane de-icing, endless computer innovations, and the list goes on and on. All because we dared. So where are we today? On the cusp of another era of daring? I hope so. We should encourage 4 big steps forward. And here they are. First, we need to think more internationally. creating synergies in space at the international level. Why not an alliance? For example, of the top international space agencies, including America, Europe, Russia, China, Japan, and perhaps others, with the private, top private sector leaders. In an effort to get the best of all parties and get us back to the moon for good, and then on to Mars and beyond. Synergies take leadership and effort to create, and that also boils down to daring. It is time. Second, we should start thinking about more about public-private partnerships in the United States. Getting daring public sector to match daring in the private sector, public and private. The way daring in the private sector picked up the baton and ran with it in what we called, started in Mercury, Gemini, and Apollo, and Shuttle. We get more done when we work together. Right now, we could use more innovation, a clearer memory of how we efficiently got to the moon. More reliance on synergies created by public-private effort. Third, we need to refocus ourselves on what works, on hard and fast goals, efficient ways to space, the moon, and Mars, not allowing waste, profiteering, or ego to get in the way of achievement. That was how Apollo worked, with the Soviets nipping at our heels. We got there first. We did not do that to make money, but to achieve a national goal. In my view, the military-industrial space complex often acts on the notion that more spending is better, more profit is the goal, and more time is just fine. These assumptions are all three wrong. Efficiency is better than just throwing more money and infrastructure at space. Profit is fine and a valuable motivator, but it is not the motivation that got us to the moon. That was the combination of national security, national pride, and higher purpose. Finally, time does matter. At almost 90, I can tell you time is a precious resource. Having good eyes is also. We have spent a lot of time over the past 40 years on wishful thinking. I think if you had every past moonwalker and Apollo astronaut here today, they would all say, enough wishful thinking. Let's get back to action. High national purpose, the moon and Mars. Fourth and last, we need to think more about space as the future. And that means turning our attention to the next steps in human spaceflight. There are still many unanswered questions about life support, radiation, reentry speeds, returning from Mars, and how we establish a simple, cost-efficient, reusable, and increasingly routine infrastructure for human presence on the moon, Mars, and in space. And efficient cycling spacecraft continually in motion, moving by one and the other object. A transway in space to and from established inhabited destinations. My concern about preserving and enhancing institutional knowledge has caused me to set up the Human Spaceflight Institute in Texas. And increasing with nodes of participants, academic and a few brainy folks that I'll select, in addition to myself. I hope around the nation and the world with academies, engineers, and astronauts all doing what they can, the thinkers and the doers who will define our future, working together on expanding human presence in space. That is my wish for legacy. Where does that leave us? Where Theodore Roosevelt would be looking today for the future. He might, if alive today, be thinking about the first president to fly in space. Or perhaps just the first to watch humans set foot and stay on the moon, set foot and set up a camp on Mars. In all events, he would expect a great deal of this great nation, America, the world. And he would expect a great deal of all of us here today, which is why we should start to expect more of ourselves and make it happen. I have a few tidbits to toss out. These are not part of formal remarks, but I think they may be of interest to quite a few people. We have an item in our future called a gateway. A gateway is a barrier unless it is opened. If it just continues to go around, it's expensive to maintain, and it's not doing very much. To get there by 2024, we're going to start with a mini gateway. A fellow engineer said to me after I talked about my transorbit craft between low Earth orbit and lunar orbit, he said, "You've just taken the gateway and you're moving it back and forth." And I said, "Yeah, sort of. But when it leaves Earth orbit, it takes the crew with, and it gets to lunar orbit, and it meets up with the lander. And the new crew gets in the lander, the old crew gets out." Now, they can talk to each other for a week or so before the old crew comes back with the Orion, back, penetrates the atmosphere and lands on Earth. But the trans-orbit craft, consisting of support systems, parts of the initial gateway, the power propulsion element, and some of the other support items, it keeps going. And it gradually comes back with solar electric propulsion, saving fuel. So it gets back to Earth orbit for the next orbit that goes to the moon. It takes a while, maybe, to get back. Now, in a couple of years, I hope we develop a craft that goes to the moon, comes back, and we reuse it. It aerocaptures. It's a buzz craft. And when John starts telling me time to get off, it's time to bring up some other people and chat about all these good things.
Dr. Aldrin. So our panelists, this slide, our panelists will join us, Rick Armstrong, Doug Wheelock. I even have formal introductions, more than is needed for Buzz. Rick is an independent consultant and software developer and a musician with Edison's Children, which is a progressive rock band. I'm too old to understand what progressive rock means compared to anything else. And he's a member of the Board of Trustees of the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation. And has been traveling the world this year as part of the kind of moving team of people celebrating this anniversary. Rick Armstrong. Dr. Wheelock is an active astronaut. He's had 2 space flights in 178 days in space. STS-120 in 2007 in the International Space Station, where he commanded Expedition 25. He's an Army pilot with 38 combat missions under his belt, has flown 46 different aircraft and spacecraft, was the NASA man in Star City for a number of years, and is still waiting for the next flight, hopefully soon. Gentlemen.
Thank you.
So Rick, let me, while Buzz catches his breath, let me start with a question for you. As I said, you've been traveling a lot in the past 6 or 8 months in celebrations of the Apollo anniversary. Give me the one or two impressions you carry away from the interactions in those celebrations.
Well, the first thing that comes to mind is that the Apollo program still means a lot to a lot of people.
Why?
I don't know that I could answer that specifically for all of them, but I would say that, you know, the inspirational value of what was done back then had an amazing impact on so many people all around the world, and that still, they still like to talk about that.
Doug, as someone involved in 21st century spaceflight, what impact does Apollo have on your organization, your conduct, not you specifically, but today's space flyers?
Well, thank you, John. I feel very fortunate because I was a wee little boy when I watched Buzz and Neil walking on the surface of the moon. And I knew it was a huge event, but I grew up in a very small place on the west side of the Catskills in upstate New York. And of course, that was in July. When we started school in September, we had a brand new teacher. And I was just going into the fourth grade. Her name was Christine West. And I remember her coming in. She was right out of teaching school. And we used to kid with her that she would, she came to this little school to pay penance. But she said, "Who saw the moon landing?" And I raised my hand. And she said, "One day you could do that too." And we thought she was crazy. And it was years later at an astronaut reunion that that I had a little chat with Neil Armstrong. And Neil shared with us that night that, you know, his thoughts when he was on the moon, and Buzz had shared similar thoughts where they thought about the teachers that taught them through the years, the engineers that built the rocket. And I remember Neil said to me, said to all of us, he said, I sat there wondering, how does a young boy from Wapakoneta, Ohio, end up standing on the moon? And we all kind of chuckled a little bit. And the reality set in at that point was like, we're all just ordinary kids from ordinary places with extraordinary dreams. And so the Apollo mission is what gave me hope for me to be involved at NASA. And so I got to NASA in the late 90s, and my last name is Wheelock, so they call me Wheels. And now the younger astronauts call me Papa Wheels. So I feel very privileged to be in a position where I can bridge that gap now to where we press off. You know, Apollo had a twin sister, Artemis, the goddess of the moon. And now we're going back to the moon, and we're going to stay there. And we're going to, by 2024, we're going to see the first woman and the next man step foot on the lunar surface. And that's very, very exciting for me. And in my latest, the last couple of years, as John had mentioned, I've been working in Star City, training our astronauts to go to the space station. And we just witnessed the first unmanned spacewalk about a week and a half ago. We had two women outside, Christina Cook and Jessica Meir, and I'm so proud of them. And they know that Papa Wheels is proud of them as well. But this is so exciting for us now because the future is ours. It's ours to claim. Just like, much like Buzz was saying, it starts from here in the human spirit, and that's the gift that NASA has given to me. And I am so excited to be part of this grand adventure and bridging the gap from Apollo and what we learned from that and take it on to Artemis, back to the moon to stay, and on to Mars as well.
Thank you.
Perfect example of what I was talking about.
Right, exactly. Buzz, I have a somewhat technical question for you, and you have to hold the mic close, I'm told. Your bosses back at the Johnson Space Center, Bob Gilruth and George Lowe in particular, suggested, in fact, canceled two Apollo missions because of their high risk and some cost elements. Did you folks that had actually flown the missions get involved in the discussions of
the risks involved and how you thought they were acceptable?
I was kind of long gone by that time.
No, it wasn't. It was
1970. Moved on back to the Air Force. But what you're describing is something that all of us, I think, in the astronaut business did not believe that we felt that the risk was the reason that we would cut short that magnificent program. We had funding difficulties. We had a conflict going on in Southeast Asia. We had lots of different pressures. Man, we can see them today, the different swings back and forth of the sense of what we should be doing. Should we be doing Apollo applications, doing more activities on the moon? What about preparing to go the next place? I regret to say that whatever the reason was, it placed a horrible barrier in progress from what we had built together in spirit, cooperation, interplay of industry and government, and unity of objectives. Sure, we used the rocket to begin to build a space station of its parts, the upper stage, and we built Skylab. And we learned a good bit out of that. And I think that set the stage for the Russians to put up the Mir space station. But before I left NASA in April of 71, I had been at the Air Force Academy for 2 years before I went over to Germany to sit on alert with nuclear weapons. Then I came back from there to MIT, then got into the space program. But having been at the Air Force Academy when it
just
first
started.
Opened up, I thought, geez, when I leave astronaut business, that's a good way to get back into the service. After 11 years, 3.5 MIT, 7.5 in Houston, man, a great idea. The only trouble was I had a classmate whose last name was Vandenberg, and he got that job. So they decided to send me to command the test pilot school. I had not wanted to go through the test pilot school training before. I wanted to stick with operational combat preparation units, and I still did. Not testing airplanes. Not that that isn't a wonderful profession for very, very dedicated, talented people. And my commander in Apollo 11 was the epitome of that kind of a professional test pilot.
What was his name again?
Oh, the all-American boy.
I have a question for Rick related to his father.
Okay.
No, I'm not going to talk about the movie. I'll just ask the question. January the 1st, 1969, Neil Armstrong, a couple of weeks before he was announced as the commander of Apollo 11. January 1st, 1970, Neil Armstrong, having been the first person to step on the moon. Was there any difference in the person?
No, I don't think so. I mean, he said, I can remember, that he felt like some people treated him differently after the flight, and he didn't know why that should have been. So I think he was, you know, he was a very principled guy, and nothing's going to change that, you know. So, I mean, what changed was the, you know, the external.
Yeah, the surroundings.
The demands on his time, and it's impossible to explain how much that was, probably. But internally, no, I think he was exactly the same.
Great. Doug, you've had the experience in Russia in making a partnership work between two very proud countries with their own ways of doing business. Has that made you a stronger advocate of international cooperation? How have you dealt with all the inevitable problems of making different cultures work together? And then you commanded the station. Who was your crew while you were commanding Expedition 25?
So we had three Russian cosmonauts and three U.S. astronauts on our crew.
But no other countries for the...
No other countries during my mission.
Yeah.
We were right at the tail end of the assembly of the space station.
Okay, so the other modules weren't up there
utilization.
Yet.
Well, we actually had all the modules up there at that point, and we were just bringing it to full utilization for all the laboratories on board. But my time in Russia, I look back now, and it's the most enriching moments of my life because I was a little nervous going over there, of course. My Russian was horrible to begin with. And actually, Alexei Leonov, the very first spacewalker we just lost a week or so ago, Alexei was such a great mentor to us because he was a true ambassador in helping us. And he told me some funny stories about his learning to speak English during the Apollo Soyuz days. And so we kind of laughed about that. But the enriching parts of it, what I found out very, very quickly working over there, that fire that burns inside of our heart and our spirit, the human spirit, the spirit of exploration, the spirit of just wondering what's over that next horizon, those fires burn ever so brightly and just as strong in the spirit of the children and the cosmonauts and the Russian people as well. So it was a beautiful experience. You know, obviously it was difficult sometimes, geopolitical things going on, but at our level, at the cosmonaut level, the cosmonaut astronaut level, we were one team. Adna Komanda, we used to say, one team in space and on Earth and training. Through this opportunity, I had, of course, have had opportunities to spend time with political officials over there as well as the president of Russia. And all of them, when we talk about collaboration and cooperation, they all point to the International Space Station. We can get along up there. We can work together to build the most amazing engineering feat of all time, this castle in the sky. If we can do that, we can surely do that here on Earth as well.
Thank you. Buzz. In your long career since Apollo 11, you've had the opportunity to interact with a lot of U.S. presidents and vice presidents, maybe even today. You have any anecdotes to share about those interactions and what they've thought about why we should be doing this and what we should be doing? Or is that privileged conversation?
No. Well, I'm not sure maybe which comes first. I remember President Carter introduced us to the public as Apollo 2. One. ever since Apollo 11 is X1 for me, just so you don't make a mistake. It was a most moving trip that the crew made after Apollo 11 came back and we were out of quarantine. Three flights were in quarantine. We were the first arbitrary 21 days after we left the surface of the moon. When we got out of quarantine, we made a trip to New York, met the mayor, a parade, went to Chicago, Mayor Daley, a parade, went to Los Angeles, a state dinner, President Nixon. The crews were given the Presidential Medal of Freedom. And then we went back and changed our clothes a little bit more, and then we went on this round-the-world trip to Mexico, Colombia.
50 years ago today, you were in Africa.
Where?
Africa.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. At high noon, seven national anthems with the sweat dripping down. King Mobutu. That was an experience, and we had many different ones. In India, visiting with the Shah and Faradiva. In Spain, Franco.
Marshal Tito.
Oh, yes. And the boss in Yugoslavia was not Marshal Tito, but Madame Broz. At least that's what people... And it was just a fantastic trip. And it was called Giant Step. And I have been dreaming of another trip called the Next Giant Leap, made up of the international partners, space agencies, NASA, ESA, Russia, Japan, China, and then we bring in the commercial SpaceX, Blue Origin, and it's an alliance that's open to other India, Australia, Saudi Emirates, and I even talked today about bringing Canada out of the European Space Agency.
Well,
and partnering them with Mexico and Brazil here in the Western Hemisphere.
Well, I think it's
going?
That kind of coalition that's going to make something in the future happen.
I don't like the word coalition. It sounds like you've decided who you are and that's it.
So what word do you like?
I'd like an alliance of those capable of doing something.
So you have to be able to contribute, not just for political reasons.
Oh, yeah.
That is a contribution.
And it has a space exploration operations center, Mission Control in Houston, Texas. And what we need is a space exploration operations plan. Not our plan, NASA's, not Europe's. We have to come together, not a UN or anything like that. It's going to take people with the background of bringing ideas together to try and figure out how we can equitably come up with something that aims toward the future. My Human Spaceflight Institute is going to take diverse points of view, and it's going to be sort of toned down by the aerospace company.
They're going to make you behave rationally.
You think very carefully about what that is.
Yeah.
It's an end run around vested interest, big companies, lobbyists who know where the workforce manufactures.
So you want to put this town out of business?
So they know just where to go in the House and Senate for appropriations and space subcommittees, and the budget comes out, goes to NASA for oversight. The lobbyists get there. Poor NASA doesn't have a chance. That's what they do. And that's how we got to where we are today, in my opinion.
Rick. Let me put your professional hat on, not your musician hat, but your information technology world hat. Can you see a time where we stop sending humans and let our machines, our artificial intelligence, our robotic ambassadors do most of the exploration? Or are people always going to be necessary?
Well, prediction is you know, a risky business, but and I would kind of go back to one of your first slides where the
it's men, not merely machines.
Yeah, there's, you know, at some point in the far future, when there's equivalent capabilities between AI and human, then maybe that question becomes a valid one. But for now, or for, you know, any of the foreseeable future, there's so much value that the human has that just, you know, a Mars rover can take a very long time to figure out how to do something that a human could do, you know, in 5 seconds. You know,
yeah.
They can. So from a practical matter, I think that you know, humans' importance, you know, is going to be there for as long as I can see. And the other factor, I think, is you can't forget, you know, going back to what I said about inspiration. I'm not sure that machines doing work, I mean, that's very cool and inspiring,
yeah.
But does that impact kids the same way as people out there?
Well, Doug has
I don't think so.
Spending a lot of his time this week in Washington in schools. You feel like it could be substituted by some sort of machine?
No, I think robots are tremendous cavalry, though. We can send them ahead to scout out where a good landing site is, where a good place to set up a science platform or a habitat or something. And it can sense what resources are there in the regolith and maybe in the trace atmosphere, like on Mars. So robots are definitely needed. But then that's just to prepare the way for a boot print to land on that planet.
Yeah.
Well, you're talking about preparing the way. Now, once you get there and you got people, you'd like to send the robots out to do the dirty work, okay? Now, let me pose you a question since you're on the cusp, sort of. When we go to the moon, and Blue Origin, Blue Moon, sets up an industry there, I really don't see why more and more people really have to stay there for the rest of their lives. We can take people up for 30 days, a year, and we can bring them up. Every time a spacecraft goes up, it comes back down, you can bring other people back down if you have enough spacecraft. Now, I've done the same thinking with regard to Mars. And if you bring the same number of people back that you send up there, There is a steady state number of people, depending on like six people up and down, somewhere around 36, 54, that's all, if everybody comes back.
So we would not settle Mars. We would not
settle Well, not
settle
that way. Now, here I am a member, or you are a member, of the pool of 50, 60 people selected, and we'd like you to commit to go to Mars and stay there. But you're not so sure about that. So what we're going to do...
Put your mic up.
Oh, what we're going to do is try and send you to the moon. You're going to spend several weeks there seeing what it's really like. Okay, then you're going to come back. And as you approach age 30, you're mature enough to come to grips and make the commitment to migrate. And that is sincerely what I believe we should be doing. We should be preparing on the moon the steps, the habitats, all the support systems. While we're executing things, we should be doing that at Mars so that when those first people get there, they don't stay a year and a half and then come back and then send another group that stays there a while. And then they come back. I mean, they worked real hard as the group to be the first group and the second group. Now the third goes there and they stay. They become the heroes of their nation, the pioneers, the pilgrims, the people of humanity who will be remembered in history. The guys that come back, they write a book, they play golf, and who cares? I'm really serious about how important it is to be able to commit to send people there, and that's where they're going to be. I'm sure that there will be reasons why there are exceptions, perhaps medical, perhaps some others.
Maybe they
it's a great science fiction story I'm working on. That's to do with mental health.
We're about at the end of our assigned time. Doug,
I'm guessing that was a rhetorical question from Buzz. So anyway, but very well said, Buzz.
Well, I have a question for you. When the picture of the Artemis 3 or 4 crew is put up on a screen like this one, you hope to be in it?
Oh, I likely won't be. I would love to be. I would love to be. But one thing I discovered, they don't call me Papa Wheels for anything. So for nothing. But so I'm a little bit older in the astronaut corps now. We have a lot of young folks coming along, and I discovered, you know, we're all kind of writing our own story, and in our story, we're the hero. And what I found is the magic in becoming a hero in someone else's story. And so my mission now is to make sure that our astronauts get there safely and get home safely as well. That part of Kennedy's speech, you know, return them safely to the Earth, is very important to us at NASA, of course. And I'm working in the area of safely returning our crews to Earth. I would love to be on that first mission.
Don't think it's likely.
I would love to be on it, and if I'm selected, I will joyfully go. But I will be rejoicing because I know that those first people to step foot back on the lunar surface, we all of us will have played a part in getting them there, and I'll be just beaming with pride.
We thought it was a good idea to come back home, too. But there was a specific problem. And if we didn't solve it, we would not have come home. Had to do with the engine arm power supply.
Right, which you solved with a pen, right?
Well, yeah. There's a circuit breaker that has to be closed to get power to the circuit that goes to arm the engine. And the circuit breaker is out when you don't want the engine to light. And that's before you make the descent. When you land on the surface of the moon, you pull it out. So you're ready to go. Now, if you're clumsy and moving around with that backpack in a pressurized cabin, I don't know where to point the finger.
Wasn't me.
But I had to be one of two. Well, we have reached the appointed end time. Let me remind people what I said at the start, that don't hope for autographs or I think even selfies tonight. It's too many people, and these folks are at the end of a long day. Let me thank Doug Wheelock. Let me thank Rick Armstrong. Buzz, a few minutes ago you talked about people who would be the ones that stay on the moon, on Mars, and who will be remembered in history. When we remember the history of the 20th century, the name Aldrin will be remembered. You're a piece of human history who's still doing it, and thank you for being here.
Well, I'm staying right here.
All right, thank you all.